Welcome, students, to Lesson 6 of the Urban World topic. In this series of lessons, we are looking at our NEE Urban Area case study, the story of Rio de Janeiro. In this lesson and the next, we will be focusing on the poorest parts of Rio de Janeiro, the favelas. Please write the date, title, and learning objective and have a pen and paper ready to learn. Time to review prior learning. Please write 1 to 10. Answer the questions from memory and then mark your answers. Game time. Number 1. What are the poor, newly built places in Rio de Janeiro called? They are favelas. 2. What is the oldest zone in Rio? It's the central zone. 3. In which zone is most of Rio's industry located? The north zone. 4. What is the richest area of Rio called? Barra da Tijuca. 5. Which empire controlled Brazil until 1822? Portugal. 6. Urbanization is the increasing percent of people living in cities. 7. The invention of fertilizers and modern medicines contributed to rapid human population growth. 8. Better education is an example of a pull factor to urban areas. 9. Energy conservation means using less energy, for example by taking public transport or using energy-efficient appliances. 10. What city in northeast Nigeria is frequently affected by terrorism from Boko Haram? It is Maiduguri. Please give yourselves a mark out of 10. If you got 8 or more, you've really understood and learned the key ideas. Please write any questions you got wrong and test yourselves on them in a week. To introduce the favelas of Rio de Janeiro, I'm going to show you a picture and then I'm going to show you some questions. Please answer the questions using your understanding. Here's the photo, a scene in a typical favela in Rio de Janeiro. Try and answer these questions. So, number 1, describe what you see. Well, you should have said you see graffiti on the walls, you see garages, you see broken, derelict brick or concrete walls. You see a child running down a very narrow alleyway with bags. You see soldiers with guns, police on the cell. And you also see graffiti. It looks like a fairly poor or dangerous scene. 2. Suggest where in Rio de Janeiro this may be. Well, this, as I mentioned, is a typical scene in Rio's favelas, especially in the more violent favelas of the north of Rio. 3. Why do you think the police are there? In the favelas of Rio de Janeiro and Brazil generally, crime is higher than in other parts of the city. I will explain why. The police are there to try to reduce crime because reducing crime leads to many other benefits for the people that live there. Not just better safety, but also more access to jobs, better education. 4. How might this problem prevent children from getting an education? So there's crime in the favelas. Why would that prevent children from getting an education? Well, there are two key factors. The first is that if there's violent crime in the streets, for example, gunfights, that prevents children from going to school. You don't go to school, you don't learn. However, there's also the fact that gangs attract children who are not doing well in school to them, because gangs provide another source of income. And so the police are there to get rid of the gangs and reduce crime. In this lesson, I'm going to explore with you the challenges of living in favelas, and then next lesson, we will look at how Rio de Janeiro has tried to solve these challenges. And in this photo, you see one way they've done that. So, what are favelas and why do they grow? First important question. Please write the subtitle and underline it. So a favela is actually a fairly simple idea, and it's not based on the quality of the housing, but rather the status of the housing. Let me explain what I mean. A favela starts as a squatter settlement. This means that the house and the settlement where people live is built illegally. The people have not got permission from the government to build those houses. Consequently, these houses can be demolished and removed at any time by the government. In Rio de Janeiro, this happened frequently in the 1970s and 80s as the government wanted to get rid of favelas in cities and build proper housing. Additionally, squatter settlements often lack government investment and government support. Consequently, they have low quality housing, and they are built and improved over time by the people using what small incomes they have, such as adding concrete and brick and steel roofs and electricity. Very little of this is supplied by the government, unlike a formal settlement, such as in the rich parts of Rio, like Barra da Tijuca. Squatter settlements have grown in Rio de Janeiro and other cities in Brazil because of migration. In the 20th century and continuing today, migration to the cities of Brazil, especially Rio de Janeiro, has been extremely high. Too high for the government to be able to build affordable, quality housing that is connected to the internet, that has good sewers and wide roads and public transport. Consequently, when the people arrive in the cities, they are forced to build these homes on illegal land in difficult locations, such as on the hills of Tijuca National Park, which is where Roxinha, Rio's largest favela, is located. A favela is what happens when a squatter settlement grows into a large community, such as this. This is Roxinha Favela. So a favela typically is considered to be a number of squatter settlement homes that exceeds 1,000 homes, at least. That's the smallest type of favela, but it has no limit in the size it can attain. In Roxinha, more than 100,000 people live there today. That is the key idea of a favela. They're usually poor, they are illegally built, and they lack government services and government support for improving themselves. However, here's an important idea. Not all favelas are equal. The oldest favelas in Rio tend to have better quality of life, better services, better housing than the newest ones, as the people who live there have had more time to improve their homes. Consequently, when I describe the challenges to you in a second in favelas, you have to remember this important idea, that not all favelas have equal amounts of challenges. Let me show you. So what are the challenges? Well, the first idea you need to understand is that the challenges of living in favelas come from principally, which means mainly, a lack of government support. At the start, in building houses and building roads and building infrastructure such as sewers and electricity, and also throughout the life of people in favelas. For example, there's a lack of police. So let me show you how this creates challenges. Consider the life of a typical child in favela, a school-aged child. When they wake up in the morning, at least 10 years ago, this was a typical situation. They'd wake up, and because of a lack of investment by the government, there was inadequate infrastructure. They might turn on the lights in their squatter settlement home in a favela in Rio, and the lights might not come on because the electricity was not being supplied to the favela. Or what electricity there was being supplied was being stolen illegally by people attaching their own wires to the electricity cables, meaning that none was left to reach them. So a lack of government investment has meant there's inadequate infrastructure. 10 years ago, more than 20% of people in Rio's favelas lacked clean water, and more than 30% lacked access to sanitation, so sewers and good toilets. Additionally, the mother or the father of the child is sick. What happens? They can't immediately go to a hospital. There are a shortage of hospitals in favelas. Why? Because the government hasn't invested in them, in the equipment, in the building, but also the doctors don't want to go to favelas because of crime. So there's a lack of healthcare. People die younger in favelas than in the rich parts of Rio de Janeiro. And finally, the child gets to school. If they're lucky, they get to school. And what do they encounter there? Very large class sizes. Larger than the average class in the rich parts of Rio de Janeiro, what's called the asphalt parts of Rio. There are few teachers, and very often teachers don't even turn up because they're scared to turn up or they're underpaid. Or when they do turn up, they're underqualified. They don't know how to teach the children well. So the education of the children in a favela in Rio suffers. Sometimes, however, The children can't even go to school. Why? Because they have to earn an income. This is because unemployment is pervasive, which means spread all across Rio's favelas. There are a lack of jobs for people and for the parents. And consequently, the parents may encourage the children to get jobs at a young age. Unemployment, averaging more than 25% in some of Rio's favelas, limits people's incomes and makes them desperate. It also makes them less able to invest in improving their home and their lives, or even to consider moving to a better part of the city. And finally, unemployment and a lack of investment in services such as healthcare, education, and infrastructure lead to crime. Probably the most famous and important reason that favelas are famous around the world is their criminality, the rate of violent crime in them. Now, this is a reputation that isn't often fair. Sometimes they're considered to be more violent than they are, but in the past they have been very violent. A child going to school often hears the clack, clack, clack sound of gunfire over their head or from around a street corner. Schools are frequently closed in favelas because of violence and bullets striking the walls, and so children miss out on education. This photo here is from a group of soldiers, child soldiers, as part of the Red Command, the biggest gang in Rio de Janeiro. Crime stops education. It also increases unemployment. Let me explain. Because of high crime rates in Rio de Janeiro's favelas, businesses do not want to set up shops there. They do not want to invest there. Banks often do not invest and set up in favelas, meaning that people can't get loans, and so they can't use that money to set up businesses or pay for their children's education, leading to higher unemployment because there are fewer jobs and people lack the money to start businesses. Crime also stifles investment and education further. Children can't go to school because of the threat of violence. Doctors don't want to come to work because of violence. And the government doesn't want to invest in infrastructure, again, because of crime. And so there is this relationship between crime, investment, and unemployment in the favelas that prevents them from being improved. It's why if I told you this 20 years ago, as opposed to now, life hasn't changed that much in some favelas. It hasn't improved that much as a result of crime and a lack of investment by the government. Rio de Janeiro is a deeply unequal city. The favelas are very poor, not only in terms of money, but also in terms of quality of life, because of crime and a lack of healthcare and education. If you look at Roxinha favela, the largest, crime rates are half what they are in Mare favela in the northeast of the city. In Mare favela in the northeast of the city, 35 days of school were lost in 2017. So 16,000 children lost their education for 35 days in 1 year. That's more than a month of school education, dramatically reducing their ability to perform in maths and other subjects, and therefore preventing them from accessing good jobs later on in life, which encourages them to get involved in gangs, as they provide the only source of possible income. You may notice by looking at these two photos a certain feature of the people that live in favelas. Most of the people that live in favelas are not European migrants. They're not descended from Portuguese colonists or recently arrived European migrants. They are the descendants of former slaves. Brazil received more slaves than all of America did during the slave trade. And when slavery was abolished, and Brazil became independent, many of these former slaves were the ones who remained poor and uneducated and moved into favelas. Consequently, in favelas, the ethnic makeup is mainly black, former African slave demographics, whereas in the wealthy parts of Rio, such as Barra da Tijuca, you have far more European migrants. It's why you have a British international school in Barra da Tijuca, but not one of those in Rio's favelas. Okay, time to assess learning. Question 1. How does the poor health in Rio's favelas affect education? How might it affect education? Well, you should have said that education might be negatively affected because if people are ill, especially children, then they are less likely to be able to attend school. Consequently, they are less likely to be able to access high-paid jobs, leading not only to a temptation to get involved in crime, but also a lack of investment by businesses, since there's a lack of skilled people in favelas, but also higher crime. Question two. What natural hazards could you think of that might affect favelas more than the rich neighborhoods of Rio de Janeiro? Well, you could have said that storms may be more likely to cause landslides and flooding in favelas than in the rich neighborhoods because the favelas are often built on soil hills and without stable foundations, so they often collapse after storms fill up the soil, leading it to cause a landslide. Question three. How might a large police force presence in Rio's favelas help to improve quality of life there? Well, you could have said that it would directly improve quality of life because it would reduce murders, homicide. It might also reduce theft, allowing businesses to make more profit as less of their stock is stolen. It might reduce gang violence and also the temptation of children to join gangs. And finally, it might encourage business and governments to invest in the area because it's safer. Consequently, they are more likely to gain high-skilled employees and profit. Okay, time to embed learning so that you never forget it. Look at these questions, answer them using your understanding, and then mark your answers. Go for it. So question one is all about this graph. Remember, when you compare a graph and different features of graph, you have to use both numbers and describe the pattern, how they're different and similar. So compare means how are they similar, how are they different? Okay, let's go through the answers. So number one, about the murder rates in São Paulo versus Rio. So look how I've got these keywords and I've compared the similarities and differences. Make sure you have all 4 points here. Add any correct parts. Two, education in favelas. Any of these points. Key ideas. Crime, poverty, the fact that the government often thinks that, especially in the past, that favelas are not places where it should invest because they're illegal, and also gangs. Three, European migrants in favelas. Make sure you talk about education and skill. And finally, four, unemployment and crime. Make sure you explain all these points clearly. Try and check to make sure that you used all these four keywords, or five keywords. Correct your answers, add any parts that you got wrong or missed, and then give yourselves a score out of the total. Next lesson, we're going to be exploring the solutions to these challenges in Rio's favelas. A project has been conducted in Rio over the last almost 30 years, and I'm going to show you what it was and how successful it was. Join me then.